According to nutrition and food justice advocates, food deserts or lack of access to healthy foods is one of the leading causes of unhealthy eating. A food desert is a zip code that does not have a large formatted food store, like a supermarket or a club store. But governments have been pouring money into these areas to create access to healthy food.
In the United States, just for example, based purely on this hypothesis, the combination of state and federal measures have probably since 2010 combined to over $1 billion in spending on grants and subsidies to put supermarkets, farmers markets, and other large format stores into food deserts to remedy this inequality.
However, research from Chicago Booth's Jean-Pierre Dubé suggests that eliminating food deserts will not necessarily lead to healthy eating, because shoppers there, particularly lower income shoppers, might keep buying unhealthy foods.
The food desert crisis broadly targeted geographic areas where households did not have access to our conventional supermarkets and large format grocery stores, and therefore didn't allegedly have access to the same types of nutritious options. We study markets from both the supply and demand sides, and when on the supply side we see something not being supplied, one theory is that it's not demanded. In other words, if consumers don't want healthy food, then we wouldn't be surprised to see a lack of stores selling healthy food.
Dubé, with his co-authors Hunt Alcott and Rebecca Diamond, decided to test their food desert hypotheses.
First thing we wanted to do was confirm that indeed we see nutrition inequality. We took the Kilts Center's data, which is a partnership with Nielsen. We have access to really hundreds of thousands of households, and we observe everything they buy when they visit stores that range from supermarkets to grocery stores, convenience stores, drug stores, club stores, etc. And we matched these data up with another database that had the nutrition content of pretty much all the food and beverage products that are in those Nielsen data. And as a result, we could actually say something about the nutrients that were in the products being purchased by these hundreds of thousands of households. The next step then was to carve up the data based on the incomes of the household, and sure enough, we saw a pretty striking gap between the wealthier and less wealthy households. In other words, if you just took households and sorted them, let's say, by quartile, if we took the four quartiles of the income distribution, we'd see a really strongly increasing relationship between income and healthfulness of the foods that people are buying.
And what happens when a big supermarket opens in a food desert?
In our data, we have quite a lot of households living in areas that we would call food deserts, in which we also get to observe the entry of a store, a new supermarket, partway through the sample. So we have over 1,000 of these supermarket entries, which allows us to set up an event study. And in the event study, we can ask the question, before versus after entry, right? Do we actually see a change in the healthfulness of the shopping baskets of households in these areas that get these new stores? And the simple answer was, we see virtually no change. No change in the healthfulness. Let me qualify that. We do see that when a big supermarket enters your zip code, when there wasn't one there previously, there's a pretty high chance you're going to start shopping there. But it doesn't change the composition of their shopping basket. Merely what all it does is it starts diverting expenditure away from the further away store where they used to shop to a closer store.
Having healthy food available closer to home didn't change what people bought. But why was that the case? The researchers wondered, is healthy food more expensive in food deserts?
So we started looking at the price of healthy food across different areas, and contrary to the food desert hypothesis, it actually turned out that prices were slightly lower in food deserts than in non-food deserts. So if anything, the price of a healthy basket of food is actually slightly cheaper in the areas that we would think of as being more disadvantaged.
That's not saying that a healthy meal is cheaper than one loaded with fats and salts. But Dubé says that availability and regional cost difference are not driving unhealthy eating.
We concluded that at most, the food desert hypothesis, which is about the availability of healthy food, the presence of big format stores, and the prices of healthy food, explained at most 3% of that nutrition income relationship. So if we're trying to understand why wealthy households have healthier food than poorer households, at best, 3% of that gap is explained by the food desert hypothesis.
If that's the case, what is causing unhealthy eating in food deserts? The researchers think it's consumer preference or taste.
So we then devised an empirical strategy to try and use the Nielsen Kilts data again to try and measure consumer preferences for nutrients, for the various nutrients that comprise the foods being purchased. And what we find is that over 90% of the gap in the healthiness of the products being purchased by the wealthiest and poorest households in our sample is associated with preferences, and less than 10% of that gap can be associated with the availability and prices on the supply side.
If that's the case, how can policymakers encourage people in low-income communities to eat healthier? Unfortunately, it's easier to build new stores than it is to change people's tastes.
We're still left with this unsettling fact that poorer households are buying and consuming less nutritious food than wealthier households. We have a story about preferences, and the preferences story seems quite compelling, but from a public policy point of view, we also know that preferences are really hard to change. Preferences tend to be a reflection of your lifetime experiences. Clearly, we need more research investigating how we change people's nutrition preferences if we hope to change that nutrition gap.